This is Bellville South, Cape Town, on the western tip of South Africa. Cape Town is rich in its diversity, with colorful people from all walks of life and cultures. Part of what is called the Cape Flats, you'll find our little town of Bellville South. Historically, the Cape Flats used to be known as the apartheid dumping ground. It's the area that the apartheid government designated as non-white through the Group Areas Act in 1966. So-called blacks and mixed people, also known as colored people, were forcefully removed from central urban areas to live in government-built townships and schemes in the Cape Flats. To this day, almost all the communities in the Cape Flats remain poverty-stricken with serious social problems that include a high rate of unemployment and disturbing levels of gang violence, drug abuse, and prostitution. Part of the Cape Flats is Bellville South. Bellville South is a place where there is no fear of God. People die on a weekly basis, from drug overdose to being shot in the street in broad daylight. Right there, in the midst of this evil, God has planted a Reformed Community Church. This is where we grew up. This is where we call home. And this is where we as a church seek to serve and make Jesus Christ known. We want to see the glory of God in the salvation of sinners. I am Mario Menable, and this is the story of how God has shown great mercy to Bellville South. See that little boy that's sweeping there? These are members of the community. They're not members of the church though. They just feel the need to do something, clean up here a little bit. It's a good thing. It's one of the guys looking after the church. Oh, this is the building.
Wow.
That we prayed for so long.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Right where we've just passed now, was somebody was killed right there on the property.
Is that where the guy was stabbed?
Yeah.
The killer was a 15-year-old boy. Gangsterism is a huge aspect of life in Bellville South. The saddest cases are gangs comprised of children, 6, 7 years old. The majority of gangs just aren't made up of adults anymore. Grown-ups take on the role of leading the next generation of thieves and murderers. They are the ones placing the gun in the hands of children. It's common to see huddled groups of kids as young as 4 gambling beside the gutters, giving up what little they have as the dice spills from their fingers.
And those kids will kill each other for 2 rand. They will stab each other for 2 rand.
The grandmothers of Bellville South are in their late 20s and 30s. A 12-year-old child will be raped, and in a decade, her daughter's story will be exactly the same. There is no elderly wisdom here, no life lessons to be learned when the mothers themselves are still children. What could they possibly teach their daughters? It's an evil, vicious cycle.
One of the youngest women, I think she's in her 30s, she's got 12 kids. There's one in the 20s, he's got 9 kids. So you can just imagine how that plays out. They don't care about education. They've got no goal for anything better than what's here. So we get babies, we get money for those babies. We don't care really about the babies. And if I get a deformed baby, I'll get more money. So while I'm pregnant, I'll do drugs, I'll do all of those things so I can get a baby that is not so healthy, so I could get more money from the government. So that kind of stuff is happening. And so then you get those 2-3 year olds on the street that have to survive. And so you get a 3 and a 4 year old that is already streetwise, that knows where to get food, how to get it, how to defend himself, all of those kind of things. It's they're just kids and babies on the street. So you'll get that in our streets. And so you can imagine how that kid grows up.
While walking in the streets, we came across a young boy with an empty look in his eyes. Mario has spoken with him many times, sharing the gospel at every opportunity. The boy's mom spends her time in drug houses. He is neglected due to his mother's lifestyle. While she spends the night in drug dens as a harlot, he sleeps on the streets. He's seen evil things, more than most people will in their lifetime.
You've seen stuff that you know is evil, it's not right. But Jesus is the one that has been protecting you. So he's the one you must look for. He's the one you must seek after. Not these things. Don't try to be like the gangsters that you see. Don't even try to be like your dad. See? Look, find Christ. It's the only way.
While we were talking with the boy, a woman walked into the park and entered a makeshift drug tent. Mario leaned into me. That's his mom. The woman saw her son but said nothing as she entered. When she came out, she was oblivious. It was sad to see this small boy watch his mother destroy her life. Sad, but nothing new for the children of Bellville South.
So that is the cycle. If we talk about hitmen, there's a lot of kids that are hitmen. You are already small killing people. So by that, when you're 18, 20, you've killed, you don't even know how many people you've killed already. So that's what's happening in our community. There's a lot of churches, but none of those kids will be in a church or go to a church or something like that. Or if they are in the church, they won't hear the gospel. You ask them anything about the Bible, they won't know. Yeah, that's what you will get when you come in. A lot of brokenness, a lot of heartache that's happening. And then when you look really well in our community, you find some people whom Jesus has saved. And when you hear their story, you can't believe that they're still alive and they have joy and they can speak beautiful things about the Lord.
HeartCry missionary Theo Robertson was involved in prison gangs, drug addiction, dealing, and robbery. While in prison, Theo even acted as the leading priest of Islam for the inmates. Years later, God convicted Theo while he was in a drug house with his girlfriend. Theo was high, running on 3 days of sleeplessness, and had just robbed a store when the Lord pierced his heart.
I used to sell drugs in that house. And in that same house where I sell my drugs, I got saved. I bent my knees and I cried out to the Lord to save me. And that's how I got saved. I'm currently serving as a deacon in the church. I'm very passionate about evangelizing, going out in our communities, reaching out to the people. I have a passion for street preaching and just to reach our community for the Lord Jesus Christ.
So yeah, we are walking the streets of Bellville South now. We are about to evangelize. We are going to a place called the Health Kitchen. So that is where most of the drug dealing stuff is going on and all the gangsterism, so most of the stuff is happening there. this is one of the guys that I used to operate in the streets of Bellville South. That I used to catch on all the wicked stuff. We used to belong to the same gang. And I would just like to encourage you. Fuck the way.
Now he's talking about the fact that it's like in the days of Noah that Jesus said people are going on as if there's going to be no judgment, nothing. And so he's telling them, you guys are sitting here, you guys are going on as if there is no God, no judgment coming. But it will happen, it's going to come.
Previous to his ministry here in Bellville South, the closest Mario ever got to legitimate faith on his own was as a charismatic tent revival evangelist in Cape Town. But Mario himself was unsure of what he believed. Saturday evenings of sinful debauchery conflicted with his sermons of supposed sanctification the following morning. The immoral, money-making lifestyle he led, influenced by infamous charismatic leaders, conflicted with what he read in the Bible.
And so the question popped into my heart, into my head, maybe you're not preaching the right gospel or the real gospel. And that bothered me. And so I did what every modern day guy would do. I go to Dr. Google and I Googled, what is the real gospel? And up pops Paul Washer's sermon that he preached to this youth on this youth camp.
The only thing that could save a people like us is the death of God's own Son under the wrath of His own Father paying the price. Rising again from the dead, powerful to save. This is the gospel of Jesus.
I was trying to figure out what the Bible teaches about the gospel. So I'm in the book of Romans in that week while I'm struggling with this issue. And so Paul Washer is preaching and he's mentioning all the things that I'm seeing wrong in today's Christianity. And he's agreeing, this is wrong.
You will know them by their fruit.
And that one sermon from Paul Washer, it was like lining up the stars. All of the TBN guys are wrong. Nobody told me this ever. I wasn't influenced by, he never mentioned any of them, even in that video. It was just simple, preaching the gospel, sowing out the errors of what Christianity has become, and I understood that this is wrong. Went to Sermon Audio, because there was a link on that thing to Sermon Audio. That time, there was 174 sermons of Paul Washer on that audio, on that Sermon Audio. I downloaded every single one of them and started listening and just learning. And then he was talking about Spurgeon. I don't know who Spurgeon is. He mentioned Spurgeon. So I Googled Spurgeon. Okay, yes, Spurgeon. I read Spurgeon. He's talking about John Flavel. I'm Googling. I'm reading John Flavel. I'm reading Jonathan Edwards and Martin Lloyd-Jones. And all of those guys that he's mentioning in his sermons is now educating me. And so that's how my life became just transformed completely.
Mario moved to the city of Kimberley, planted a Reformed church, and looked into the process of becoming a missionary to Ecuador. This wouldn't work out. Mario was sent back to Cape Town, joined a local church plant, and started working in the office of another missionary organization. But the church didn't appreciate his new Reformed teaching. Over the course of 6 short months, seats emptied. In a year, the church was void of a congregation.
I'm looking to maybe we the problem here, but it was the Lord just cleaning everything out.
Mario dove into the Word, searching for what a biblical church actually looked like, and applied what he found. Mario wanted to return to what was actually modeled in Scripture. How did a church service operate? What was an elder or a deacon? Was anything they did not supported or seen in the New Testament? Mario prayed to God for already Reformed men who could come alongside him to assist in the work that needed to be done in Bellville South. In just a few years, God started answering that prayer.
So when we found the church, all the stuff that we were looking for, that we were sort of running away from in the charismatic church, we found. So we didn't have all the lights, we didn't have all the heavy guitars, the music, the smoke machines and the atmosphere, but we didn't have any of that. So that for us sort of shifted our focus more on biblical truth, biblical theology, instead of going there for things that don't benefit your soul.
One Sunday morning, I went to go look at this church. It was like a connection for me. Like, first time I went in, I felt this is the one that I think I'm going to be attending. Yeah. Of course, the truth that was preached on the pulpit was made it very easy for me to say, look, I don't care whatever else, it could be in a school, but this is where I belong. And I also realized that, look, there is a need. And I wanted to serve, actually. I wanted to be in a church where I would be a full service.
I came to visit, and the brothers were just, I mean, they were loving, they just overwhelmed me with just brotherly love and just being there for me. And then Mario came to visit me a couple of times and we started talking, and then I came to the prayer meetings and the prayers were different. The prayers were, we are praying for so-and-so by name who has just shot so-and-so by name down the street yesterday, or we are looking for a certain gangster that has just shot 3 people down the street. We want to reach out to him and pray with him. And I thought to myself, this is different. I'm definitely not joining these guys because I don't want to die. So I didn't come here to die, so I'm definitely not joining here. And then there was a youth that I started seeing around, and I thought, yo, these kids. And so in my prayer time again, I'm praying for these kids, and I want to see how they're doing. I'm now interested in all of that. But I couldn't shake this off. So I decided, let me see.
Mario prayed in earnest. Wasting his time at work when he could be pastoring and evangelizing full time was weighing heavy against his heart. God answered his prayer in the form of an email from Pastor Conrad Mbewe, which connected him to HeartCry Missionary Society. At last, the door had been opened for him to serve the Lord on a full-time basis.
It was amazing. It was crazy because it was because of the ministry of Powassa that I got reformed, and now many years of this, almost like full circle.
Mario was able to dedicate himself to the ministry, and as already established men in the faith entered the church, Mario's prayers turned to the souls of the community.
The vision we had, and we still have, is souls getting saved, you know. Will we have the capacity for that? And so when we started praying for the building, if I can bring that in, I mean, we were at the school, we had about 8 or 12 people at the time, trusting the Lord for our own place, for a building. And then COVID came, and now we're out of the school because we can't meet there. And so we have to meet at our house. There's people in the lounge, people in my kitchen, people in my dining room, people in the middle, or there's like a middle section in my house. And so we have church every Sunday like that, and it's cramped. But the problem is we can't invite people. So the people that used to come and visit our church, we can't invite people now. And so obviously we still, people are still coming, and there's still visitors coming, and we're just squeezing everybody in. And we still pray. And our heart for it was, our plead was, Lord, don't give this building into the hands of gangsters or into the hands of Prosperity Church. If it fell in the hands of gangsters, it probably would have become a brothel or something like that. If it's a Prosperity Church, that's even worse. That's clear to us, God is judging our community. And we were praying for mercy. Please, God, just show mercy to our community, not just to our church, but to Bellville South. This would just be the Lord showing us His grace and His mercies, and that's exactly what the Lord did for us.
The reason why I was calling, wanting to be a part of this call, was can you give me just a rundown on where your church is meeting right now?
We're meeting at my house at the moment. The difficulty we have now is what's frustrating and why I wanted to build on top of the house is because we can't really get all the visitors in and the people in the community in that wants to come to church.
Did you mention something about thinking about building or something in your house? Or?
Yeah, I was going to build on top of the roof. I was going to put the structure on the roof. It would have been big enough to at least fit 40 people in there. It wouldn't have been big enough to fit everybody in there, but at least just a space for the church.
What are your plans with regard to finances or whatever?
We don't have the money. So obviously we are looking at our brothers and sisters that's got money to help us out. And we've raised about 530,000 rand.
And how much is that in dollars?
So
about $30,000 US.
About $30,000.
So yeah, you guys raised $30,000. That's amazing.
But we've literally basically given up on that building. Since all of the everything we tried just fell to the ground. We thought, okay, maybe the Lord doesn't want us to have this building.
It would be a major victory, wouldn't it, though, if that building was used for the Lord now?
Of course. Definitely. And there's so much that we can do. It's just crazy.
Yeah.
If we just have the facility. There's a lot of work here. A daycare center that we can run from there. A clinic that we can run from there. A school of theology that we can run from there. During the week, having soup kitchens. That's what we want to do. These are things that we have done. So in the past, which proved to be effective. So there's a lot that we can do with this building.
Just wants to tell you one little bit of news real quick.
God's going to give you the building. It's been approved.
Wow. Yeah.
So, what is this, 5 years of praying for that building?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, brothers. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you, Lord.
God has been very, very gracious, and
sorry, guys, man. At that moment, it was not about the building anymore. Because actually, when we were praying for the building, it was not about the building. It was about the gospel of Jesus Christ being proclaimed throughout this community, and this building as a testament of what God does. You know, so the tears that came and the unbelief, sort of, that awe moment for me had to do with that.
Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. It was about God.
his love and his grace towards this community.
Sorry, man. This is 5 years of joy.
I think what's so amazing for me is that, you know, the building, it was built for all the wrong reasons.
Yeah.
Yet God was using evil reasons years before you even knew about it to build you a building.
Wow.
The church building was erected in the midst of South Africa's apartheid. White church hadn't allowed South Africa's black and mixed people to become a part of their congregation. This church was built to keep them separated. The residents of Bellville South were insulted, and the building was instead used as a general event center, if it was used at all. But God wasn't finished. About 50 years later, a beautiful thing happened. A building of segregation turned into one of fellowship and unity between all people.
I grew up in a Christian family, even though I come from a Pentecostal background. As I grew up, I went away from the teachings of my parents, even though they didn't know about it. But when I came to Cape Town, because I'm from the Eastern Cape, so when I came to Cape Town, that's when I finally knew who Christ is, and I finally committed my life to Christ. What I also appreciate about our church is that it is a community church. They go beyond church service. They take you to their families. You get to see how everyone lives, not pretending and raising hands at church. So you get to see how they disciple their children, and basically how they just hold devotions in their families. So I'd say I've learned how to belong in a community of church members.
Got the gospel now, and the gospel is in that building, proclaimed from that space. You know, so it's the community rejoiced when they heard that we get in that building.
What has it meant seeing the church, God give the building to this church? What is that like?
That's
yo.
So, wow.
We suddenly, they told us that we got the building that they've been praying for before we even got here. Like, it was amazing just to see how God works and how he takes care of his church.
So we are thankful for the Lord that we continue to pray and to be faithful in praying and just serving the Lord in this Bellville South of ours that we love.
Amen.
So here's the big announcement. This morning, we signed the papers of the building. Glory! Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. They thought this day would never come. Amen. Yeah. Somehow, amongst our prayer, we were pleading in desperation, please, Lord. But we actually never thought this day will come. That's the day. Isn't it beautiful that we could do it even today to sign that papers on the Lord's day? Hallelujah. Let's just pray and give the Lord.
I remember dancing when we were told that we got the building.
I couldn't believe it. I I asked them to show me the papers. I said, I need to see it in writing. I need you guys to show me the papers that says that we are getting this building. So if one thing that I think it has done for this church is to show us that the work that we are doing here is not because of what we are capable of. It's what God is doing. And we are just vessels that God is using.
It is a real blessing for us so that we can impact our community with the gospel and to reach the lost for Christ.
You look at where the building is situated, it's literally at the center of where everything is happening. It's at the center of the gangs, center of your drugs, your prostitution. It's at the center of every bad thing that Bellville South is known for. And then God decides to put a church there, a biblical church there.
Pray that the Lord would keep this leadership on the knees. Pray that we would walk with the Lord, that we would be in His presence, that we would seek Him. His church is special to us. It's even more special to Him.